Hi guys, thank you for being here. Next we have Dr. Weir reading her original poem, Me, You, Body.
Sick the first part of the semester. Just had a terrible time. It was the first really major illness I've ever had, and I was in the hospital, I had surgery, and I thought a lot about the body, my body. And when you're sick, you deal with doctors a lot, so you deal with doctors thinking of your body as white blood cells and potassium counts and all that kind of thing. So while I was recuperating, I thought about that, so I wrote this poem about that we see our body. If I look at my hand and you look at your hand, you say, well, that's my hand. But if I think about white blood cells, I don't think of them as mine. So this poem is an attempt to try to bring my body together. Oh, I see the outside me, skin-covered bones, knees, wrists, feet, but I don't see the inside you, organs, microbes, white cells, tissue, blood. Would that I could swim within, ride the fissures, the arteries, push through plaque, mingle with cells, course those long blood rivers. Then I could know all of me and you, seen and unseen, body. Then I would not call you, you, finding you or me, me, body. Oh, I wish to push myself inside out to know the all of me.
Next, we have Dr. Munro reading from Mary Stewart's Merlin trilogy in honor of Everest.
So I had to do this, everybody, so you must bear with me. This is in honor of a new baby in my family. So there is a new baby in my family, a baby boy.
Books are good.
And there's three of them. And I'm not reading them all. Reading a tiny bit out of the beach. So these are wonderful books by Mary Stewart. They are an Arthurian trilogy. They are told from the point of view of Merlin. In fact, it's Merlin speaking. And they're the whole Arthur story, the wonderful Arthur story about Merlin as a child, Merlin becoming the great wizard, Merlin being instrumental in the birth of Arthur, and then in the raising of Arthur, and in the aiding of Arthur to find and to raise the great sword and become the great king that manages to stave off the Saxon hordes for a while in Celtic Britain after the Romans leave, before the Anglo-Saxons take over. Anyway, so there's a new baby in my family, and in honor of him, I want to read these few things. So I told my daughter before, as she was in her late pregnancy, you have to read these books. She knew she was gonna have a boy. And I wanted to be sure that they thought hard about the kind of boy they wanted to be and the kind of name they might give him. So, in my own way. So, she read them all. And the baby's not named yet. The baby's almost 2 weeks old, guys. This is my family's pattern. They bring home an animal or a child, and they wait until somehow it's revealed to them what the name should be. They still got a dog that has multiple names. It's a very cute dog. So they've been really working on this name. And all I know is that one of the child's names will be Emrys. It's probably not going to be his first name, Emrys. So E-M-R-Y-S. It's a British name, or it's a Welsh name. It's the Welsh for Ambrose. So it's got all these associations, and the one of these great Roman leaders who is legendary in England as the Romans leave, and he leads the
Celtic peoples as well, is someone named Ambrosius. Anyway, he's woven into the whole story, and he's also called Emrys. One of Merlin's names is Emrys, and one of Arthur's names is Emrys. So this is for Emrys. Now the first thing I'm going to read is, you know, only an ag writer could do things like this. So keep that in mind, people. You know, drag out books and read your favorite things. So this is a little, this is a poem written by Edwin Muir at the beginning of this wonderful trilogy. You all should read it. By the way, it's not just this wonderful Arthurian story with all the fantasy and everything. It's beautifully written. So this is a poem called Merlin. Oh Merlin, in your crystal cave, deep in the diamond of the day, will there ever be a singer whose music will smooth away the furrow drawn by Adam's finger across the meadow and the wave? Or a runner who will outrun man's long shadow driving on, burst through the gates of history and hang the apple on the tree? Will your sorcery ever show the sleeping bride shut in her bower, the day wreathed in its mound of snow and time locked in his tower? Second part. This is from the book in which we have the birth of Arthur and the birth of Arthur and the youth of Arthur. And it begins with a poem. Now, the second part of this poem, my daughter posted on Facebook with pictures of her baby boy. There was a boy born, a winter king, before the black month he was born, and fled in the dark month to find shelter with the poor. He shall come with the spring and the green month and the golden month, and bright shall be the shining of his star. That's Mary Stuart. And this is the very last of all in the trilogy. Merlin has returned to his cave in the wild hills of Meridian in Wales. He is old. All the great things have happened. Arthur is king. There is peace. He has united all of the little petty kingdoms of England, the feudal lords, and they've all become one kingdom under Arthur. It's that wonderful time that, you know, they think of Camelot and so on, this ideal sort of time. He has fought the great battles, and he comes and visits his uncle, Merlin, regularly in Meridian, visits the cave. So this is the last part as he comes to visit Merlin at the end of the trilogy, and then I will read Merlin's song. He came again yesterday. Something had called him down to Caerleon, he said, so he had ridden up just for an hour. When I asked him what the business was in Caerleon, he put the question aside till I wondered, then dismissed it as absurd, if the journey had been made merely to see me. He brought gifts with him. He never came empty-handed. Wine, a basket of cooked meats from his old kitchen, the promised harp strings, and a blanket of soft new wool woven, he told me, by the queen's own women. He carried them in himself like a servant and put them away from me. He seemed in spirits. He told me of some young man who had recently come to court, a noble fighter, and a cousin of March of Cornwall. Then he spoke of a meeting he was planning with the Saxon king, Eos's successor, Curdic. We talked till the dark drew in, and his escort came jingling up the valley track for him. Then he rode as lightly and as always now when he left me, stooped to kiss me. Usually he made me stay there by the fire while he went out into the night, but this time I got up and followed him to the cave entrance and waited there to watch him go. The light was behind me, and my shadow stretched thin and long, like the tall shadow of old, across the little lawn and almost to the grove of thorn trees where the escort waited below the cliff. It was almost night, but over beyond Meridian in the west, a lingering bar of light hinted at the dying sun. It threw a glint on the river, skirting the palace wall where I was born, and touched a jewel spark on the distant sea. Near at hand, the trees were bare with winter and the ground crisp with the first frost. Arthur trod away from me across the grass, leaving ghost prints in the frost. He reached the place where the track led down to the grove, and half turn, I saw him raise a hand. Wait for me. It was the same farewell always. Wait for me. I shall come back. And as ever, I made the same reply. What else have I to do but wait for you? I shall be here when you come again. The sound of the horses dwindled, faded, was gone. The winter's silence came back to the valley. The dark turned down. A breath of the night slid like a sigh through the frost-hung trees. In its wake, faintly, like no sound but the ghost of a sound, came a faint, sweet ringing from the air. I lifted my head, remembering once more the child who had listened nightly for the music of the spheres, but had never heard it. Now here it was, all around me, a sweet, disembodied music, as if the hill itself was a harp in the high air. Dark fell. Behind me, the fire dimmed, and my shadow vanished. Still, I stood listening with the calmness over me of a great contentment. The sky, heavy with night, drew nearer the earth. The glimmer of the far sea moved, light and falling shadow, like the slow arc of a sword, sliding back to its sheath, or a barge dwindling under sail across the distant water. It was quite dark, quite still. A chill brushed my skin, like the cold touch of crystal. I left the night with its remote and singing stars and came in to the glow of the fire and the choir, and the chair where he had been sitting and the unstrung harp. And here's the Merlin song. Rest here, enchanter, while the fire dies. In a breath, in an eyelid's fall, you will see them, the dreams, the sword and the young king, the white horse and the running water, the lit lamp and the boy smiling. Dreams, dreams, enchanter, gone with the harp's echo when the strings fall mute, with the flame's shadow when the fire dies. Be still and listen. For on the black air blows the great wind, rises the evening tide, flows the clear river. Listen, enchanter. Hear through the black air and the singing air the music.
For Emrys.